everybody stand up and sing one more hallelujah. Give me praise to the Lord. I can never tell you just how much good that is gonna do you just to sing anew the song your heart learned to sing when he first gave his life to you. The life goes on and so must the song you gotta sing again. Were before you heard the song, you gotta let them know the truth is alive to shine upon the way, so maybe they can go sing your praises once more. Sing your praise to the Lord. Come on everybody, stand up and sing one more hallelujah. Give your praise to the Lord. I can never tell you just how much good it's gonna do you.
And welcome to today's sanctuary service. I hope you really enjoyed that little glimpse behind the scenes to see just some of the people who help prepare and distribute our sanctuary service week by week, as well as some of our much loved local members of our church family. Well, whether you're watching locally or from further afield, we're all going to go on a journey together back to where we left off last week. Back to the shores of Lake Galilee, back to that breakfast on the beach with Jesus and his disciples. Today we have the Baines family bringing us our reading and prayers, and I know for a fact they like plenty of time on the beach. Henry is bringing our reading all the way from Brazil, Miranda a special prayer from Cardiff, and Caroline and Andrew will bring our prayers from a bit closer to home. I'm also really looking forward to hearing what Claire Parr has to say, her reflections on this special Bible passage. In the passage, Jesus says to his disciples, "Come and have breakfast. Come and have breakfast." Well, I don't know what time of day it is when you're watching this, but whatever you had for breakfast, the invitation is the same, that we come and we share time in God's presence. My prayer is that each one of us would closely know the presence of Jesus with us and speaking to us as we share this sanctuary time together. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, open our lips,
and our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
Give us the joy of your saving help,
and sustain us with your life-giving spirit.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith.
Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Amazing love, how can it be?
John chapter 21, verse 15 to 25. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all these things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Because of this, the rumor spread among the believers that this disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you?" This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written.
Risen Christ, by the lakeside you renewed your call to your disciples. Help your church to obey your command and draw the nations to the fire of your love, to the glory of God the Father.
It's really lovely to be with you today, albeit virtually, and with high hopes that we'll soon all be together again in person. Today we're looking at the final passage in the Gospel of John, at a bit of a tricky conversation between Jesus and Peter. Now, I don't know what came into your mind when you heard the reading for today, but as I read the passage in preparation for this talk, the words, "I am," kept going through my head. And not the holy name of God, "I am," but rather the "I am" that usually comes after requests like, "Please would you get your pajamas on? Please would you brush your teeth? Please would you stop licking each other?" Even when said activity is decidedly not being done. When my children say, "I am," to me, their tone of righteous indignation is because they are fully intending to do what I've asked. The fact that they're often doing the exact opposite at that moment seems to be of little consequence, because at some point in the future, they intend to do it. Many commentators call this passage the restoration or the reinstatement of Peter, in which Jesus, in a sense, replaces Peter's three times of betrayal or denial with three times of calling and commissioning. And there's no doubt that restoration is what's going on here. But as with so many of the gospel stories, there is much more happening than just a one-dimensional tit for tat. I think what's happening here is not only Peter's restoration, a physical, public, "we're okay now, right?" but something much deeper. I think Jesus is putting his finger on a sore spot, a weak spot, an area of Peter's life that needs to change in order for him to flourish as the early church's key leader, in order for him to be the rock that God has called him to be.
Peter has an I am moment with Jesus. And in that moment, Jesus is showing him where his intentions don't match his actions, where his words don't line up with his deeds. We can't really understand this passage without looking back at Peter's heartbreaking betrayal. But I think we need to go back even further than that. I have great sympathy with Peter, or maybe affinity is an even better word, as he goes crashing around the Gospels. He's a person of great passion, of great urgency, of great intention. He is a grand gesture kind of guy. It is, of course, Peter who leaps out of the boat to walk on water with Jesus, but then is overcome by fears and flails helplessly into the sea. It is, of course, Peter who first demands that Jesus never wash his feet, and at Jesus' gentle insistence, backtracks, and then suddenly insists Jesus wash his entire body, thereby entirely missing the whole point of what Jesus is trying to show his disciples. And it is, of course, Peter who swears blind that he will never desert Jesus. And within hours, within earshot of his friend and teacher, has gone blue in the face, denying any knowledge or connection with him. Peter has such noble intentions, but all the intention in the world doesn't get the job done. And that's because our intentions are based in our own strength, and dare I say, our own egos, what we want to do for God rather than what God wants to do through us. There's a story from a book I read as a teenager that has stuck with me all this time. The story was about a charity aiming to regenerate a particular inner city neighborhood in Chicago. The decision was made to clear an area for a park with large grassy areas and free flow play equipment. Much time and energy and money was spent on the project. Upon its completion, however, the park was rarely used by local children or family and fell into disrepair. The charity had great intentions, but it hadn't had the humility to ask what the local community needed or wanted. It turns out that wide open spaces and unsupervised play equipment was perfectly suited to drug dealers and gang members, and actually made the neighborhood less safe than it was before the charity's efforts. When the charity finally went back to find out what the community wanted, they found out that what they really wanted was a gated play area where there could be adequate supervision and children could be safer from the more nefarious elements within the neighborhood. The charity had wanted to do something for the neighborhood and ended up doing harm through their own intentions, their own agendas, their own strength. Intentions are based on our own strength, what we want to do for God rather than what God wants to do through us. When we look back at the account of Peter's betrayal, I think this idea of intention versus action is at the very heart of the story. It's easy to read it as a one-dimensional passage where bad Peter betrays Jesus, but I think it's so much richer than that. I think Peter's intention is to stay near Jesus, to find some way to help him that night. It strikes me as a pretty risky gamble that Peter is taking in going into those courtyards being as recognizable as he is. The way I read it, following Jesus to the high priest is an act of great courage, based in Peter's deep love and devotion to Jesus. But it's also based on Peter's own strength, on his own ideas about what Jesus needed from him. Betrayal, swearing he had never even heard of Jesus, denying all the richness, the renewal, the love of the past 3 years, came as the consequence of putting his own ideas, his own ego, above the character, life, and work that Jesus was calling him to. How often do we do this? Some of the recent revelations of abuse that have finally come out about some well-respected Christian leaders have left me pretty shaken and devastated. One of the recurring themes of the scandals and why it's taken so long for some of the events to come to light has been because of the repression of accusation and evidence in order that the Christian witness and legacy of the leader not be damaged. In other words, the end of not wanting the message of the gospel to be tarnished has justified abhorrent behavior and victimization. Now, these are extreme examples, but we ourselves are not immune to this kind of intention either. With good intentions, we can justify not giving of our time or money or talents. We can justify talking behind people's backs. We can justify electing leaders who protect our interests to others' detriment. We can justify polluting and consuming and decadence. We can justify just about anything. And like Peter, we can betray and deny Jesus. Because, of course, Jesus is not a means to an end kind of guy. He is not so interested in the grand gesture of Peter saying and doing anything just to achieve his goal of staying near him that night. He's interested in authenticity and humility. He's interested in the feeding of sheep. He's interested in Peter following him no matter what the consequence. When Jesus asks him again and again, "Do you love me?" Peter's hurt in the way that my children are hurt when I ask them to do something over and over. He's childishly and churlishly insulted that Jesus will belabor the point of his betrayal. "I am," you can imagine him saying. But when Jesus asks Peter, "Do you love me?" he's not asking for a grand gesture. He's not asking for good intention. He's asking for Peter's weakness. They say that every preacher only really has two or three different sermons, and this is one of mine that honestly I'm preaching more to myself than to anyone else. Strength is not strength in God's topsy-turvy kingdom. 2 Corinthians 12 verses 9 to 10 say, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may rest on me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong." Our weaknesses, the cringy, the awkward, the embarrassing, the odd, the faulty, they are our greatest strength. Not because those things are good or nice or wonderful, far from it. They are our greatest strength. They are worthy of celebration. They're worth bragging about, Paul says, because when we recognize in humility just how imperfect, how weak, how ridiculous even that we are, that is when God's strength, God's power, can be made perfect. That's when we can get our egos out of the way and let God do something with us instead of insisting on what we can do for God. I think it's also important to say that when Jesus asks Peter to feed his sheep, I don't think he was asking Peter to change who he was. Sometimes we get this idea that there's one type of person who's best suited to serving God, and that's who Jesus was asking Peter to become. Far from it. I imagine that long after this conversation, Peter was still the life and the soul of the party. I imagine he could still tell a really good story. I imagine he was still expressive and comedic and a little over the top. Because that's who Peter was. That's who Peter was made to be. And God is not in the business of changing who we are, who he's made us to be. One of the biggest revelations to me in my Christian life was about God's love for and design of who I am. I think we can get so stuck in the trap of thinking, if I was just a little bit more like her or a little bit more like him, then I could really minister well, I could really serve God brilliantly. It's really a whole other sermon for a whole other time, but that kind of thinking denies and demeans God's creative action in making us who we are, in effect saying God didn't get it right. So I don't think God was in the business of changing who Peter was. I think he was in the business of oh so gently pointing to all Peter's grand gestures, all the empty words, all the human effort. And I think he was refocusing Peter on God, on what God could do with Peter in all his weakness, and away from what Peter could do for God in his own strength. Now, Peter's response to Jesus' call is not what we might think fitting for the end of a gospel. Channeling his inner four-year-old, he again misses the point and has a "What about him?" moment. But change takes time, doesn't it? Even as he moves to the fringes of the New Testament action, we continue to hear about some of the poor decisions he makes, but also some good ones. When Peter challenges him over his lack of inclusion of the Gentiles, he holds his hands up and in humility changes his behavior. Peter's restoration came in the form of three questions. Peter, do you love me? And three exhortations, feed my sheep. But Peter's call, which is the same call that Jesus gives to each of us, is as simple as it is hard. Simply, follow me. How will we answer that call today? Amen.
First of all, we're going to pray for the situation around the world, particularly for all those places that are badly affected by COVID, and particularly holding up to you the situation in India and in South America and in other places where treatment is really difficult and vaccination is problematical. And thank you for the science that enables us to protect ourselves against these things. And just bless all of those involved in the care of people and the relief from suffering. And Lord, there are lots of places where there is civil unrest, and we just pray that you'll look upon the situation in Myanmar, and that peace will prevail there. And thank you for international cooperation, not just over the pandemic, but in relation to the environment. Thank you that the United States, the new administration, is taking a different attitude towards climate change and what might be done about that.
Now, closer to home, we pray for our country and our leaders. As we come out of this very strange time, help our leaders to make wise decisions about how and when to lift restrictions. Protect us, Lord, from an increase in COVID again, as we start to see one another more freely. And Lord, protect us against new variants of this disease, which could undermine our vaccination programme. Thank you, Lord, for that vaccination protection that we've got so quickly. Thank you that so many of us have already had our vaccinations or are about to have them. And we just thank you for this and are determined not to take this for granted. But as we enjoy our new freedoms, help us to remember those who are still contracting COVID or who are still suffering from its after effects. Give them the help they need, Lord, to recover properly, and give them hope that things will improve. And as our country moves forward out of lockdown, I pray that we can emerge from this a kinder and more tolerant society, in which we deal with each other with greater gentleness and understanding, especially with those whom we disagree.
And Lord, we hold up to you our city and our region of Bath and the west of England, thinking particularly of those of the new west of England mayor, but all of those who are in political power or administration. Please bless them and give them the wisdom to make wise decisions. And thank you for all of those who work in public service, the police, the emergency services, and those who work so hard in our National Health Service. Thank you for them and for their diligence and dedication to public service. And pray that you will bless them.
And Lord, we think about our church community. We pray for wisdom for our church leaders and for all those involved in ministry around us. We pray especially for those involved in finding and choosing the right person who will guide the church ministry with young people.
And Lord, we pray for ourselves and our families and friends. Stretch out a protective arm over us. Keep us safe from danger and from evil. And we pray that we will be a blessing to all of those around us. And we offer up all these prayers in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh,
Jesus, Son of God, let your love shine through our eyes. Your Spirit inspire our words. Your wisdom fill our minds. Your mercy control our hands. Your will capture our hearts. Your joy pervade our being until we are changed into your likeness from glory to glory. Amen.
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Well, thank you so much for joining us at Sanctuary again today. And thank you to everyone who has helped put this service together. I hope that as we finish, you feel uplifted and inspired as you face the week ahead. Thinking about Sunday next week, you've got a choice how you take part in our Sanctuary service. If you receive a DVD, those will be delivered as usual, and our online service will be available from 8 o'clock in the morning next Sunday. But you could also choose to come along to church and take part in service in person, and that will be at 9 o'clock at All Saints Church here in Weston, Bath. If you'd like to do that, then please do go on our church website and book a free ticket so that we know how many people to expect. If that's a little bit early in the day, there's also going to be an 11 o'clock service at the church, which if the weather is fine, will be in the open air. Again, please book a ticket online if you plan to come to that, and that will be an all-age service. As we close, I do hope that this week is a good week for you. And as we finish, I couldn't think of a better way of closing a picnic on the beach with a bunch of fishermen than with a sea shanty. So I hope you enjoy this. Goodbye.
Oh, there once was a man from Galilee, and he spoke of a wondrous mystery, a kingdom of equality, a kingdom built on love. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. And he healed disease, but word soon came to the Pharisees. They wouldn't accept, no, they couldn't agree that this was the reign of God. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. And he called the scribes, whitewashed tombs full of death inside. They wouldn't accept, no, they couldn't abide that this was the word of God. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. Him up and they beat his back. They thought the kingdom could be attacked, but they did not know that with every whack it was closer than before. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. Said, still there is no crime, but the priests and the people cried, crucify. So they hung him up on the cross to die, and the Lamb of God was slain. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. until the Lion of Judah roared as he rose up from the grave. Hey, soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. Soon may your kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. Now the kingdom's here and the kingdom's free. It's an open secret, it's a mystery. It's for everyone who has eyes to see his victory of love. Soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above. Hey, soon may the kingdom come and be revealed to everyone. Soon may your will be done on earth as 'tis above.